Well, welcome to the Beyond Cinema Studio here at Sundance, Jason, Mark, Scott. Firstly, congratulations on having the movie here. Seeing the film with other people, with an audience, seeing yourselves up there, just give us a sense of what that's like, what that feeling is like, if it's cathartic or super crazy, you making you more neurotic. Like, what's going through your mind when you're watching that with people up here at Sundance?
For me, what's difficult is, I mean, this is about honoring our brothers, honoring our fallen, and how do you ever say enough? How do you say it properly? You always feel like you could say more. I mean, that's something that's haunted me for years. I felt that, you know, Greg and Tresha with the film were able to communicate what I've wanted communicated for years, but I've just always felt, you know, pretty inadequate in my ability to express kind of, you know, the inexpressible. So it's difficult to watch, it's difficult to hear myself, but at the same time I felt like it was just such a victory to see them communicate what's been so hard for me to communicate for years.
Yeah, I think at the end for us, you know, you're kind of experiencing the emotion yourself, and there's some very tearful things, and you're supposed to be brave and bold, but after the last credit, you know, when everybody started cheering and applauding, you're like, wow, that's pretty good, and you walk down there and they're still applauding, and you know, I just think at the end you're very vulnerable and you wonder how people would take your story, and it seemed everybody was excited to hear the story.
Yeah, just to see the crowd's reaction, you know, through the whole thing, and how much they seem to appreciate that, because this story is relatively, it's untold, it's unknown,
right?
Even within our own organization in the special forces community, what these different teams did working with these Afghans at that point post 9/11 is relatively unknown. You know, to be able to tell a little bit, to shed light on this much larger story of all these other incredible things that not only our teams did and the hardships and challenges that they overcame in accomplishing those missions, but what all these other special forces teams participate in as well.
Why do you think that is? Like, why does it take this amount of time for these stories to get told? Is it because there's pressure for you guys not to talk about them, or is it because there's no one asking those questions and celebrating those moments?
Well, there's a couple reasons, and I'll hit on it. One, it was trust. It took a long time for us to trust Greg and Tresha. I mean, we've known each other for you know, decades, and we don't talk about things we've done because we've experienced them. So why do we sit around and uncover, you know, our feelings,
right,
about things we went through? And when we first started talking to the production team and Greg about this film, I think, you know, it took a while for them to earn our trust, even to have a conversation about why we wanted to do it.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, there were previous attempts, you know, years ago. But from my perspective, though, they were disrespectful. You know, you would get a contact or a letter of, hey, we're telling your story without your participation or your involvement in that. And, oh, by the way, we're filming next week, and if you can make it, great. You know, so, you know, to have the opportunity to be a little more participatory in how our story is told, and work with them through some different topics and just how we're portrayed within that.
Yeah, because it's clear that you guys have that bond that goes way back and way deep, right? And there's those moments in the film where you're pouring the shots and kind of there's, yeah, this kind of unspoken support that you all have for each other, right? That you guys don't need to talk about it because you all were there, you all, yeah, did it. So opening up to people who weren't there, however good their intentions, yeah, just thinking that they won't quite ever get it. Now that you had that closed space, that safe space where you could talk to each other, now having a film that goes out there and will for the next however long, there'll be Facebook messages you'll be getting from people 5 years, 10 years from now, I just watched it, right?
Yeah.
And having that reaction, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Well, you've now opened up that.
For our soldiers, you know, it's there is no manual on the effects of the relationships you have during war. and you can't measure it. And if you don't understand it, seeing this film will kind of explain it. And then now we talk about the post effects of our lives after the war. And what do we miss the most? It's not the combat. It's not the tanks, the planes, the guns. It was that sense of brotherhood and fellowship. Mm-hmm. And the families, too, they miss it. They miss each other, right, because we were thrown together in the circumstance that we all had to live through together. And now that it's 15 years later, you know, we miss that kind of kinship for it.
Yeah. And you also, like, travel to such different places, right? So coming back and even just relating the sort of places you've been to and seen and the images that you have, like, not even about the war, just the image of the locations, right? You know, are there... Jason, you kind of talk about it in the film, like the places that you can escape to, right? The places where you feel that sense of calm. Mm-hmm. For each of you, where's the, I'd love to get a notion of where's that place for you.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, for me, I'm from Hawaii, so I mean, for me, it's always about, you know, kind of the beach and the mountains. You know, when Greg was trying to figure out where to film us, Haleakala is a magical place. You know, and you know, for me, that was kind of a good place to, you know, kind of go to confession. You know, it's a very spiritual place in the islands. And so for me, it was a good place to kind of pour my heart out and just leave it there. You know, it was, yeah, I mean, that's the best way I could put it.
Yeah. Mark, where's that for you?
I'm from the plains of Kansas. I grew up ranching and rodeoing, and horses were always a key part of my life growing up. So for me, it's going back to Kansas, back to our family's ranch, and just regrounding and getting back to some calm and spending some quality time with my family, with my kids.
Yeah.
So it's interesting for me. You know, I've always been a warrior at war. So where do you become a warrior? Well, not at war. And it's a buddy that you see in a film, but he's not heard, took me to Yellowstone. And we spent a month climbing the Tetons. And we took an 8-day horse mule train through the center of Yellowstone. And you were at peace because the environment, you know what I mean, was rough and rugged. There was wolves and bears and everybody was nervous, but I wasn't a warrior at war. I was just enjoying, you know, nature at itself. So
yeah, I found that interesting too, is that, I mean, even the Jeep, you know, Jeep experience, like, they were pretty calm experiences. Like, I think that some people find, like, if they've had experiences that are particularly noisy, they find peace in noisy environments, and other people find peace in serenity, right?
Yeah.
And I found it interesting that you guys seem to find peace in when it's quiet, not seeking out something where you can kind of be bombarded by other kind of loud sounds.
Well, what was interesting about Moab is where we're at, and another buddy kind of took it. You can have a great adventure, and that Jeep adventure we had that night, believe it or not, we discovered there was bears in our camp. And we'd slept through it all. The bears knew even not to bother us while we were sleeping. And but
which would have been a great aspect of the documentary.
You know, fighting a bear for our food and those bottles of beer we had in the snow. So
you and a bear sharing it.
But we didn't care about the wild. You know what I mean? We have slept, you know, in
we
places
slept out
that,
like that in a lot worse and conditions. And that was relaxing. It was, you know, doing some of what we had done before, which is off-roading.
It felt more natural in that unnatural environment than coming home.
Well, and I think, you know, for me, and you guys chime in for yourselves, but there's a trust among, you know, fellow soldiers, you know, that extended to in Afghanistan, the guerrillas, you know. But there was a trust there, and you felt safe there. And I think one thing for me that, you know, won't ever be the same is, I mean, I don't feel the same in just crowds. I don't like crowds. I don't like being around a lot of strangers. I mean, part of being away from it all is you're away from it all. You know, you're with people that you choose to be around. You're with people that you trust. And it really relates to the post-traumatic stress that, at least for me, I brought back with me. But I just feel a lot safer, I think, when I'm alone or with people I choose to be around. It just is always with me that way.
Yeah, I think, yeah, I mean, there's there's a lot that's said about how unable we've been as a country, as a nation, as a coalition, etc., to really do what we can for people coming back, right? There's no doubt.
Well, it's interesting. A lot of soldiers, when we talk amongst each other, war is not chaos. Coming home is. In war, you're the soldier. You've got the guns. You know the battlefield. You get intelligence every day. You have the tools in front of you, and you accept the violence of the situation. Coming home, nothing here is planned for us. You are back in the matrix randomly like everybody else, and that's the sense that you don't have.
Well, and nobody with PTSD, I don't think that it's that you're not trying to show weakness. It's just you're so self-reliant that, you know, you rely on your brothers, you rely on yourself. If you have issues, you call people up. But when you're back in the civilian world among family and friends from outside the military, they're just not people you reach out to.
And probably you don't want to impose that on them either, right?
Well, what they understand, and that was to me one of the big victories in the film, is you get, you know, a snapshot of all of the experience. You see the brotherhood, you see the violence of action, and you see the price you pay and what you carry with you. And that, for me, is something that's so difficult to express to people, because that's what you carry with you for the rest of your life. You know, dealing with Dan's body as we're trying to bring him out of Afghanistan is a moment that is just ingrained in you forever. You know, and that's something that, how do you express that to people?
Yeah. So that's like two questions that follow up on that. One is, who most do you want to see this? And the other is, what's the right thing for people to say? Because I think a lot of people just don't know what to say to you guys, knowing what you've been through. Where is thank you for your service enough? Like, what's the right thing to say?
I think it's families. It's interesting. I had some buddies that were involved in another movie, Black Hawk Down, and they resisted it because in special operations, you don't have your story told. You don't seek recognition or the limelight. But afterwards, it was the families that came up and understood finally what they went through and the emotions that we usually guard from everybody else but ourselves. And for that, you know, if you have a family member that served, to see this, to understand why we value our commitment to each other and our love for each other, and sometimes it's hard for us to talk outside of our circle, you know, to share that experience.
Yeah.
The film also portrays, you know, the wives and the bond that they have in that from these different teams, and those ladies, you know, at that point in time, like other ladies that are going through that now, they're very isolated and alone, and just, you know, they have to help maintain that security about what their husband is doing and where they may be at, you know,
suffer in silence
and in silence. And really all they can talk to is another team wife that's on that particular team that knows about as much as they do about where their husband's at, possibly.
Yeah.
You know, in our case, my wife was 7 months pregnant, you know, when I deployed, she went in for a checkup at 8 months, and there were complications, and she has the baby, and the wives are working with the unit command to inform me about that point. So they, you know, I'm allowed to then call home, you know, on a sat phone in the middle of coordinating a battle, you know, and talk to my wife, who's already home from the hospital. But those wives rallied around her, and I know that happens today with these different teams as it did then.
It's going to be so hard to compartmentalize that ahead of that journey that you're about to step into. Now feeling like you've got this added responsibility, this added part of yourself somewhere in the planet.
You know, had to find some peaceful moment to have that call and be able to just be resilient and bounce back from that, and then refocus on the task at hand, which was surviving the day and winning with the army that we had created.
Jason, you want to speak to who do you most want to see this?
Well, I mean, I agree with everything they said. I mean, I just, as a separate add-on, I love teaching. I taught at West Point for a few years. You know, when you meet the next generation that's coming in, I think it's so important for them to understand what they're getting into. I love my career. I would not have changed any of it. You know, everything I did, this was a life I chose, and I never regretted any of it, you know, other than the loss, but that comes with the life, you know. So, I mean, that's kind of a separate thing. Obviously, any of us would have traded places with our dead, and that's the burden that we have when they fall. But, I mean, for me, the next generation looks up to, you know, they look up to Special Forces troops. They look up to Green Berets. They want to go there.
Yeah.
And I always want them to understand everything that they're in for, because it's an incredible life. It's an intense life, but there is a heavy price for that life.
Mm-hmm. It's different than signing up for the John Wayne vision of the experience. Right?
Well, that's what they join for.
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, for me, I'll just speak for myself. I mean, you see the movies and you're like, I want to do that. And as you move along, hopefully you're introspective enough to understand that, okay, it's not like the movies.
Yeah.
You know, and then 15 years later, you reflect on it.
In movies, you see the battle and the heroism. This movie's more about the day after the battle.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? The consequences and the war and how people, you know, adjusted to it. Because for all of us, there was the next day and there was the next battle. And
if there's a movie that's gotten it right that you've seen, like just a regular kind of narrative, is there one? Is there a movie that you've like, finally, this is it?
Well, you know, let me tell you the difference of what I see. This documentary is a reflection of our stories as told by us. In Hollywood, a lot of times, you've got this magical formula of a love interest meets a villain meets, you know what I mean? And life is not a formula. So have I seen a movie? When I was a kid, a different kid movie, and the way I saw John Wayne is different than when I see John Wayne today. You know what I mean? I'm a little more mature and I see things. So I don't know if there's a representation of this generation's fight. That was Vietnam. I mean,
I don't think that movie's been made yet.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's a quote I came across recently. One man's history is another man's fiction.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there was incredible drama, you know, that happened on our mission with my team, incredible things that these guys overcame, just like happens on a number of other teams, that there are incredible stories that are out there yet untold. But, you know, how can Hollywood tell these stories when they don't know the story to start with? And I know we were pretty hard. I was pretty hard personally on Tresha and Greg, admittedly. To get this right, you know, we're trusting.
Take the time to tell it. You should take the time to understand.
Right. And can you tell me my story, you know, so that I know that you do understand key aspects that I want to help you try and portray.
And that's because you're trying to protect the 595 and the guys.
Yes.
You can't fill in the gaps with make-believe.
Yeah. There's incredible drama. Incredible things happen. But in the case of our team, where we split into three man cells, you know, how do you measure time and distance when I use the analogy of it's a 4 to 7 hour horse ride?
Yeah.
The terrain is incredible.
Think of Gallipoli, like go back to that, you know, Simpson and his donkey.
But you have three Americans that are out there with an Afghan commander, in our case, that have between 300 to 750 Afghan horsemen. And they are helping coordinate the leadership. They're the glue that's helping keep this army together. Gathering intelligence, helping coordinate logistics and airstrikes and just the maneuver that was going on in a situation where they're faced with incredible challenges.
So what's the right thing for people to say to you, either after they've seen this film or just on the street when they know about this story? Because I, as another, like, just a quick aside, it's like to have 100 people go in and achieve what you achieved and then see what happened afterwards, like, that must also be fairly frustrating because, you know, it seems like it's...
Well, at the time, I know when we left out, we had no idea what anybody else had done because we were isolated. Mm-hmm. There was no pats on the back or welcome home. I think America had shifted to Iraq. So we didn't know if we won or lost or was a failure. It was time to come home and go to Iraq. Okay, another war. Here we go. Because some of us have been in for a while where this is what you do.
Right, you talk about the 26 deployments in the film.
Well, this is, I mean, I, you know, the people could debate this point, but in my view, this was the first test of an all-volunteer army for the United States. The first Gulf War, we dipped our toes in it. It was a hard deployment for people out and back, and you know, 18 months of things that we just hadn't done in a long time. But you know, now it's been 15 years of an all-volunteer army. We have no draft. We don't want a draft. We don't want people conscripted because we're professionals. We chose a life to be professionals. The Special Forces soldiers represent people who first volunteered for the military, then volunteered for more, and they're you know, older and more mature. And you know, here we are at the end of careers that are unlike anything our military has really seen in our country's history. It is just something new. I mean, when you ask about what people should say, I always felt thank you for your service was appropriate, but I also felt that most people didn't really quite understand what that service entailed, which for me was what made this so important. Is I volunteered for this life. I love this life. By all means, thank me for my service. Thank firemen for their service. Thank police. Thank all the first responders. But this is what that service was.
Yep. I hope it inspires people to do some of their own research a little bit more, to do some of their own self-study, to maybe learn more about what has gone on over the last 15 years. I certainly hope it inspires some young men and women to volunteer and try out for the special operations community.
War is best done, fought violently and quickly, and then become over. I think we've put ourselves in a situation where we repeated this war one year at a time. And how could we have had victory with so little and so fast, and then move to the next war that was fought with victory with so little so fast? And as I look back, and my son is now in the Army, and you know, how are we still here?
Well, thank you guys for coming in.
Thank you.
Congratulations on the film. I look forward to seeing what journey this takes you all on in the next couple of years.